in this edition of Art Loft. Paper, utensils, and nature make art.
How can I make that into a paper cut? You know, how can I make that two-dimensional?
Fitting in through the eyes of a child.
It can feel lonely there, trapped in your head. Grown-ups don't see the things that you do.
A local artist refuses to get boxed in.
I found that a lot of my work kind of turns out to be somewhat on the violent side, which I don't understand totally.
And witness the intersection of nature, upholstery, art, and beauty.
I think that our ideas of nature and beauty are constructed and very intertwined.
It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years, Alva H. and Wyline P. Chapman Foundation, and
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show, and every day is another masterpiece.
Hi, I'm Kalyn James, and from Sheila Elias Studio, this is Art Loft. This week, we look at childhood flights of fancy and fungi-filled furniture. But first up is Andrea Martin, a biologist who uses her science skills to bring nature to life on paper. She enjoys the challenge of taking complex objects from the environment and transforming them into paper cuts. In this next story, we meet Martin and learn more about her passion.
I tell stories by cutting designs in paper with an X-Acto knife.
My name is Andrea Martin, and I'm a paper cutter. I've been drawing all my life. I love drawing, and I really like representational art, and I like the very graphic nature of the black and white, but I also really like the challenge of looking at something and saying, well, how can I make that into a paper cut? You know, how can I make that two-dimensional? You know, how can I show something without color? You have to kind of trick the eye into seeing something that's not really there. I want the fox to look like he's hidden behind these leaves, and I think I can do that by making hatch marks to show his fur, and that'll make the leaves stand out and look like he's behind it. The piece that I'm currently working on is a piece for the Roseville Library. I was asked to do a paper cut of a garden that would show the different plants and animals that are found in their garden at the library. I spent a long time researching what plants and animals were native to Minnesota. For example, what kind of rabbits live in Minnesota? What kind of grasshoppers was I seeing? So in some ways I wish I could just cut a grasshopper, you know, without doing the research, but I actually enjoy that part as much as I do the paper cutting. When I first went to college, I had to decide between being a biology major or an art major, and I chose biology. I'm really glad that I did take the biology classes. It taught me observation, you know, it taught me to see the world a little bit differently, and I think that this shows up in my paper cutting. It shows up in the details. I love the details in my work. I had my own scientific illustration business, so I drew graphs and I drew pictures of animals and things like that in pen and ink. Then I became a teacher, taught science for many years, always incorporating art somehow into the work I was doing with the kids in science. it's really important as a scientist to observe. I do a lot of daily walking and I look at the animals and plants and how they're interacting with each other. I look for sources of water for animals. I look at patterns in nature. Patterns in nature really fascinate me. And so if I'm out and I see a leaf that has been eaten by a Japanese beetle, I look at that and say, oh, that's a paper cut. I mean, it's beautiful. People don't like Japanese beetles. They're an invasive species, but they actually make beautiful leaf paper cuts. The paper cutting that I do, I think, have some messages sort of hidden in them. I mean, I'm interested in putting a smile on people's faces, but I'm also interested in people getting messages about how the environment is affecting the animals. I did a piece called View from the Other Side, and it shows a woodpecker all by itself in dead trees. In the background, you can see the city. I was thinking about loss of habitat for animals when cities are built and expand, especially, and what animals would survive and what wouldn't. My next paper cut, I'm interested in doing something along the lines of global warming. And so I'm planning images and things that will be on this paper, but also looking at color in my work too and how I can use that to an advantage, you know, to get my message across better. But I also like just pretty pictures.
To learn more, visit AndreaMartin.com.
From that research, I developed that video. A lot of the things that I say as the smasher are comments that I have read or heard women boxers make.
When you're a kid, sprouting wings can seem as real as taking a bath or brushing your teeth. At least that's the way it is for my kids. And Blind Spot is an animated interpretation of childhood and the desire to belong. Commissioned as part of a Borscht Film Festival series where filmmakers created stories inspired by Miami neighborhoods, Nora Solorzano's 2008 film takes place in South Miami. Take a look.
There are some mornings that crackle with electricity when the sun cuts through the darkness. On these mornings, good or bad, anything seems possible. Especially when you're a kid. When I was young, I had reoccurring dreams and thoughts about all my teeth falling out. Some were fantastically ridiculous, yet somehow they all seemed entirely plausible. When you're a kid, your greatest fantasies and your darkest nightmares are entwined with the everyday. So sprouting wings can make as much sense as taking a bath or brushing your teeth. Huh?
Mom, can I be excused?
Nonsense. You haven't eaten a thing.
But I'm so full.
You can't leave until you clean your plate.
Mom, I'm going to school now.
Okay, sweetheart. Have a good day.
It can feel lonely there, trapped in your head. Grown-ups don't see the things that you do. Do other people have the same thoughts? Till one day you find you're not alone. The hardest part is holding on to possibility.
Solorzano has taught animation at the Art Institute of Boston, the School of the Museum of Fine Arts, and Harvard University. And she recently relocated to Brooklyn, New York for graduate studies at New York University's Tisch School of the Arts. As with all Borscht Film Festival films, you can view them online at their website and find out more about their work. Just visit borschtcorp.com.
New ways to see both nature and beauty. I think that our ideas of nature and beauty are constructed and very intertwined. I think we get a lot of our ideas of beauty from nature.
Luann Kolodny is sort of a Renaissance woman. Trained in dance and theater, Luann turned to visual arts later in life. Her performance artwork is largely in video, while some of her drawings were recently on display at the Girls Club collection in Fort Lauderdale. We spent some time with Luann during her workshop at the Girls Club and in her studio in North Miami to learn more about her work.
I'm Luann Kolodny. I'm a video artist. I do drawings and installation as well. This is my second career. Actually, it's about my fourth career, but I've been doing this about 15 years now after I left the directorship of MoCA. Girls Club, they have a guest curator who goes and creates an exhibition, but those two pieces were included in the Follow the Line exhibition. For a long time, I didn't know what it meant to be an artist. I said, just because I'm drawing or doing video, which is really what I started out doing, you know, what qualifies me to be an artist or anybody to be an artist? And since Duchamp, anything you do counts for art. So that was one thing that kind of kept me going, but I felt that to be an artist that you had to kind of be validated in some way, and the first video that I did was accepted into the very first optic nerve program that MoCA, the Museum of Contemporary Art, had, so that was pretty good validation. And I'm very interested in psychological ramifications of how society affects us and how culture affects us. I found that a lot of my work kind of turns out to be somewhat on the violent side, which I don't understand totally. And it's not that I'm embracing violence, it's kind of like, I feel like by showing it or looking at it, that we will all, you know, kind of recoil from it and hopefully bring about something that is more peaceful in the world. I do like my art to kind of startle. I want you to experience it and kind of tell me what you're thinking. And if you kind of come up with what I was thinking when I did it, I think, Eureka, I did it. I realize that there is a strong strain that you can trace in my work, that it's because some of it does look disjointed. But when I saw it all together, I saw that even the pieces that aren't necessarily like the other work, there is a strong sense of who and what I am trying to do in that work. It does perform a cathartic thing for me, and it gets very personal, and sometimes I will just be stopped in my tracks because it scares me maybe a little bit. So what I'll do is I'll turn to craft to do something that's just really cut and dried and using your hands and kind of not thinking. Well, all of my video is somewhat performative. I kind of regard myself as a found object. I love to perform, and what I did in the boxing video, which is called The Smasher, that's my AKA, this Louis the Smasher Sams, and the thought came to me, I wonder how many women are out there that box, and I started getting on the web and everything and found that there's a whole culture out there of women boxers. And so I bought some books and I started studying up on it and found that most of them come to it because in some way they were broken. From that research, I developed that video. A lot of the things that I say as the Smasher are comments that I have read or heard women boxers make. And I think it shows just another phase of society and what happens to people, especially women, when they're not allowed to express their true feeling. I decided I'd just take one of the effects on the video program in Premiere that I had never played with, and I just shut my eyes and I came down, and lo and behold, synchronicity as it is, it hit onto mirrored images. So I started playing with mirrored images and with the idea of chance, because I started cutting the video up and just replacing it and not really looking at it. And then I went back and I made some nice cuts so that it did smooth out and run nicely. And this video of the hands came out. I was gonna quit after that. I was really happy with it, and I thought it was the best thing I had done. And it really turned out to look like a metaphor for life. You watch these hands just kind of manipulating, and with them being mirrored, they take on a life and they become something else. I enjoyed that as well. Those drawings that I did that are in Girls Club, I'm taking those now, and I'm taking the, because there's some collage elements in it, and I'm building the collaged elements out at least a half an inch so it becomes like a relief. And I've got about 5 or 6 characters in there, about so high now, of police officers and people being accosted and things of that sort. And I'm creating a large background for it, and we'll place these on there so it'll become a relief. And I'm also furthering my inquiry into women's boxing. I think there are going to be a couple more videos from that, hopefully.
You can learn more about Luann and her work by visiting her website at luannkolodny.com. Kate Casanova is an artist that pushes the boundaries of human comfort by using various mediums such as mushrooms, live hermit crabs, and photography. She seeks to find where the human perception of beauty and nature fuse together.
This thrift store chair and remove the stuffing from the cushions and reupholster it and plant it with straw that's been inoculated with mushroom spores in order to create a piece in which live mushrooms grow from the cushions of the chair. I always try and match the style of the chair with the type of upholstery to the type of mushroom so that the visual elements play off of each other. In this case, I'm going to be using lion's mane mushrooms, which grow in these large white clumps that have these sort of tendril forms that come off of them. And so I wanted to contrast that to the angularness of the chair and then the lush red of the velvet. In my process, I'm always looking for new ways to see both nature and beauty. I think that our ideas of nature and beauty are constructed and very intertwined. I think we get a lot of our ideas of beauty from nature. I grew up in northern Minnesota on the Minnesota-Canadian border, International Falls, Rainy Lake, and quite a bit of my childhood was spent in a home that was in the middle of the woods. We had sled dogs and always a plethora of pets, from rabbits to guinea pigs, the standard fare. So I spent most of my time playing with my brother outside and friends and exploring, and I think that my visual vocabulary assembled itself from that environment. This is straw that is inoculated with the mushroom spores. It's been pasteurized, so there's no other pathogens in the straw. It gives the mushrooms a good opportunity to sort of completely take over and colonize this substrate. So this is what the mushrooms are going to feed off of for the next couple months. The mushrooms will probably start to sprout in about 2 weeks, and then hopefully in 4 weeks they'll be in full bloom. We'll see.
I think Kate is a very interesting and exciting young artist. She has an intelligent sense of wonder about the world around her. So she's responding in a way that isn't simply emotional or intuitive. She's also responding in a way that's very thoughtful and intellectual. And it's that combination of being intuitive and intellectual that's quite unusual.
I'm drawn to aspects of nature that are sometimes unnerving or underappreciated. You know, mushrooms, for example, they're a decomposer. They're a very necessary agent of life, but not necessarily one of the most appreciated forms.
She doesn't simply use one particular medium. She's made sculpture, she does installation, she's done performance. She's made some gorgeous collages with photographs that are very beautiful. She's made videos. So she works in a variety of ways, and in that sense, her work is eclectic.
The medium changes, but the interest in cultural perceptions of nature is the common thread. For example, I have a video of hermit crabs that are crawling in my hair. The hermit crabs are the figures in the landscape, and so often that role is reversed, especially in old paintings. It's always the human that is the figure in the landscape of nature, and so it's a role reversal. So it's about that, but it's also about that unnerving beauty that sort of happens when you're a bit unsure as to whether something is safe or not. It's about that unclear relationship between us and something else. I hope that people, when they look at my work, they think about those concepts, and if anything else, just looking closer at the world around them.
Casanova has numerous upcoming exhibits. To learn more, visit katecasanova.com. Well, that's it for this time. Until next time, I'm Kalyn James, reminding you to stay creative. Thanks for watching.
Cornwall. You ready? Here we go. Don't cut off my frozen one. I can't just like, no, don't take your time. I know, right? It's like my eyes were funky. And then after I did that, I was so close to the camera that I didn't know where to look. I was like.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation. Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years. Alva H. and Wyline P. Chapman Foundation. And
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.